welcome to TNT. This is Patong Hill Road. As you can see, a lot of tour buses there carrying people backwards and forwards to various tours and of course to the airport. Economically, this is the most important road in Phuket. And because of that, economically, it's a very important road for Thailand as well. Now you can see there's a bit of a problem with this brand new alternative road. Not that many people are using it, but once they do come down to this point, they have to make a right-hand turn against the traffic coming up the hill. And if they get any volume of traffic, it's going to cause a lot of mayhem. And I think it's a bit of a safety problem. But this new alternate road, they've constructed it with some 20 million baht, mostly paid for by Patong business people. The idea being that this is an alternative road if this road has any future problems, noting that back on October the 15th, part of this road collapsed, which caused its closure and really brought about the construction of this new road. But apart from the right-hand turn here being a bit of a problem, at least now we do have an alternative to this very important stretch of road. And about 1 kilometre up there, as the road sort of meanders up the hill, there is an amazing viewpoint, as you can see right across Patong. So anyway, all the way from Patong Hill and people trying to make a right-hand turn, oh dear. Welcome to TNT. Let's get stuck into today's news. And here we are, change of costume and all. And welcome to our Thursday TNT. I know some people are going to ask, what was all the noise up on the top of the hill with all the people tooting their horns? Well, it's not a thing that's sort of magic to Phuket. It's actually just a bit of a custom when people come to the top of the hill. Some, not all, but some people do toot their horns 3 times at that Chinese temple. So that's what the noise was about. Now to our main story today, and this is going to be certainly making quite a lot of waves in Thai media, and allegations made by the Bangkok Post, immigration top brass took bribes for triad visas. So just a quick bit of background. The Immigration Bureau and the Royal Thai Police have been doing a lot of investigation into alleged Chinese triads, also been referred to as grey business. A lot of Chinese companies allegedly getting shelf Thai companies with Thai nominees and then hiding behind those to do all manner of different allegedly illegal activities and business practices. So this story from the Bangkok Post. And let's see, I'll go through it in detail. 3 former division commanders of the Immigration Bureau have taken bribes in exchange for approving applications for non-immigrant visa from more than, and this is an astounding number of people, 3,325 Chinese nationals who entered Thailand on tourist visas, according to former politician and massage parlor tycoon Chuit Kamon Visit. Quite a colourful character too, and he's certainly been leading the way as far as providing the Immigration Bureau and the Royal Thai Police with information. I would say he'd probably need to keep a bit of a low profile and lock the doors at night time. The approval of these non-immigrant visas, as the story goes, Type B and Type O, were made between 2020 and last year by the 3 police major generals who have been alleged to be involved in this campaign by Mr. Chuit. So we're talking about during COVID. These were people who were able to get into Thailand out of China and have their tourist visas converted to other non-immigration visas. 2 of them identified only by the initials of their first names, K and D, are former classmates of the Deputy National Police Chief, Surachat Hakpan. And just going on into that story, Chuit asks, I was wondering if he would ever dare take action against them. The cost of getting such an application approved was between 100,000 and 300,000 baht per person, which makes you wonder, for that money, they could have gone through the normal channels and got a visa, but perhaps they didn't qualify. down the bottom. During that time, they sought to have their visas changed to a Type B or Type O with the help of the Chinese criminal syndicate being investigated independently. And just his final allegation, a Chinese legal firm was set up to assist them, adding the Konkan-based Pranz Hanyu Foundation was also involved in the racket, allegedly. So some pretty serious allegations made there today in that lead story in the Bangkok Post. And I'm pretty sure that there's going to be more to be said on that. And certainly I think a statement would need to be made by Surachat Hakpan, the deputy police commissioner who's been leading the investigations into these Chinese syndicates. So more to be heard on that one. You're watching TNT. This is the Thursday TNT. Thank you for dropping in and just noting that today is the 8th of December and the prediction earlier in the week was the southern part of Thailand was going to be deluged from the 8th until the 11th of December. As far as the southern island of Phuket's concerned, probably some showers today, but we don't really see any deluges in Phuket today on the radar at the moment. Let's go to our next story, and this from The Nation. Tesla cruises into the Thai market. The electrical vehicle manufacturer Tesla has entered the Thai market from yesterday, offering two models at starting prices of less than 2 million baht each. I actually am a bit surprised that they are able to get them under that 2 million baht price tag. And we've got the Model 3, and it starts at 1.759 million baht. And then there's also the Model Y, which is going to be available, and that starts at nearly 2 million baht. And both those models have got versions which make them a little bit more expensive for a longer range or additional performance. Story goes on to say that the cars come with a 4-year warranty for the car and 8 years on the battery. That 8 years on the battery, that's pretty standard on most of the electric cars coming into Thailand at the moment. Tesla also announced it will open its flagship store and its first car delivery and service center in the first quarter of next year. And it's also opening 10 charging stations in Thailand. Well, the 10 charging stations that they're installing are not the only ones in Thailand. There's actually quite a few already for different makes of cars. Noting that I'm not sure if I'm correct with this, and I know that you'll tell me if I'm wrong, but I think Tesla can use some of the other standard electric charging plugs, but it also has its own proprietary plug, which allows for a faster charge. Am I right with that? So those 10 charging stations specifically for Tesla cars, I imagine there'd be at least one here in Phuket, will allow for that faster charging. But the whole electric car business is really starting to boom. I've just ordered one myself. I was going to be getting a hybrid car, but I've cancelled that order and I'm getting a different one. And I'm waiting for it at the moment. I'm going to be telling you more about that. I'm also going to be doing a car challenge of whether I can drive or how far I can get from Phuket driving to Bangkok on one charge. So that's coming up in the next few weeks or whenever my car arrives. So good news there for Tesla fans anyway. As we move to our next story on Thai PBS World, 3,500 Bitcoin mining machines were seized in raids. Now, if you want to know what Bitcoin mining is, just Google it because it's quite long and involved and I'll let you do that research yourself. Apparently, they arrested a man in raids on 41 locations. The same person in all 41 locations? The illegal operation had been running for about 2 years and cost the MEA an estimated $500 million in lost alleged electricity theft. These Bitcoin mining hubs, if you like, computer hubs, use a lot of power. And so that would have certainly added to the profits. The gang reportedly generated revenue around 4.2 million baht per month from the 3,500 Bitcoin mining machines. Now, a good question a bit further down, that there could be some MEA employees, that's the Electricity Authority, who could be complicit in the illegal operation, asking how it could be that the gang had stolen electricity for 2 years without anyone's knowledge. Well, that's a damn good question. So it looks like they've at least found the machines, and they've now got that gentleman under arrest, and I'm sure he'll be aiding the police in their investigation. As we go to our next story now, and this story from the Khmer Times, it's a no-go. The ASEAN special envoy can't make a third visit to Myanmar, noting that Cambodia is the chair for ASEAN this year. And, well, just looking at the date, the clock is ticking down as to whether they can do much to get another visit by the special envoy to Myanmar, headed up by Cambodia. The Minister of Foreign Affairs, that's in Cambodia, as the special envoy on Myanmar, will not make a planned third official visit to Myanmar with time running out. And down the bottom there, analysts have speculated that the trip will not be made because Myanmar's ruling State Administration Council, that's basically the military junta, has not shown any progress in implementing ASEAN's five-point consensus and recently sentenced seven university students detained during a crackdown to death. Well, ASEAN again backing out of their responsibilities to do at least something, and it looks like it's going to be handed to the next chair of ASEAN next year to take up that particular challenge. So Myanmar is a complete basket case, still run by the military. They're being completely capricious in the way that they're handing down sentences. I mean, these are university students. The worst they did was protest, and they've been sentenced to death. So I'd certainly be suggesting just stay away from the place until they can get some form of proper government installed there. And it probably won't happen in the next couple of weeks. To a happier story, and this from coconuts.co, Thai rapper Millie makes the BBC's 100 Women list. A proactive 20-year-old rapper was the only notable Thai to be included in the BBC list of the world's most influential women. I don't have that list here in front of me. Did they put a link to it? I think they have down the bottom there. So there is a link to the world's most influential women list at the coconuts.co website. And the story goes on to say that Millie, who rose to international fame at the Coachella festival this year, she went viral for her love for mango sticky rice. So well done to Millie there, and I haven't heard much about her performances since the Coachella festival, but of course the Thai government went crazy with her soft power and promoting the mango sticky rice during her performance. Now to my favourite story of the day, I don't know why, and a British tourist has been arrested for overstaying in Sisaket, says he loves Thailand so much he doesn't want to leave. Well, I don't know if you can really argue with him. That's a very valid and plausible excuse. If I was the Immigration Bureau, I would have gone, okay, fair enough, we'll let you go. No, it didn't quite end that way. A British tourist was arrested in Sisaket after overstaying his visa for 2 months. The tourist confessed his affection for Thailand to the immigration officers and said he loved the country so much he didn't want to leave. The 30-year-old British man, his name is Michael McLaughlin, as named in this story from thepattayanews.com. Was stopped by Sisaket immigration police while walking on a road in Sisaket back on December the 6th, which was on Tuesday. Immigration officers told local media that they'd tracked the man through their database and found that his visa had expired on September the 21st this year. And despite his affection for Thailand, Sisaket immigration officers had to charge the man for overstaying his visa for 75 days. According to the Immigration Act, the man could be fined from 500 to 20,000 baht and banned from entering Thailand for 5 years. So, as I said yesterday, if you have overstayed your visa, the very best thing you can do is pop down to your immigration office and just put your cards on the table, because at some stage you're either going to have to just live in a room for the rest of your life, or you're going to have to cross a border and they will fine you and they will probably deport you and may not let you back into the country.
To our next story today, and a story, this one from the Thailand Business News, Bangkok falls to 63rd place in the cost of living rankings. Now, when it says falls, it basically means that it's getting cheaper to live in Bangkok. So the lower the rating, the better it is for the cost of living index. And the story says that Singapore has risen 4 places in the latest global cost of living rankings. Bangkok fell 12 places to 63rd, and it's continuing its move away from the global top 50. The biggest driver behind Singapore's rise in the latest rankings was the double-digit increase in rental costs in 2022. And noting there that KL in Malaysia has moved down to 167th. Manila fell 10 places to 67th. Laos, in particular, has seen the largest fall in the rankings, falling 29 places to 193rd. And with inflation rates surging beyond 100% in Turkey, the country has become more expensive for expats and tourists. Despite the plunging value of the lira, Istanbul rose 27 places to 150th, still makes it a pretty cheap place to live, while Ankara moved out of last place to 205th, so still a very cheap place to live in that cost of living index. That story from Thailand-business-news.com. And that's the end of our program today, with thanks to Five Star Marine. If you're heading to Phuket, I can recommend that you contact them if you'd like to go on a private tour to, well, any one of the many great locations just off the island of Phuket. Thank you for tuning in today. It's been great having your company, and I look forward to doing it again tomorrow.